Hello everyone. Hello everyone. Once again, I welcome you all to my class. Today we are going to discuss about another important sanas within bryophytes, and this sanas is called Markansia. Do you know why this sanas is called Markansia? This sanas was named after a person. His name was Nicholas Marsans, and he was a director in a botanical garden in Orleans in France. And in his honor, this genus was named as Markansia. So let us start about our today's topic, that is about the genus Markansia within bryophytes. Systematically, it belongs to the family Markansiaceae, order is Markansiales, and the same class Hepatichopsida, which is similar to our earlier genus, that is Rickettsia. Both Rickettsia and Markansia, they belong to this class Hepatichopsida, although they are morphologically or anatomically quite distinct from one another. Distribution. The genus Markansia, it is composed of around 65 different plant species, and they are distributed all over the world. But in our country, that is in India, it is mostly confined to the temperate regions, and it is represented by 11 different species, which are mostly found to be growing in the Himalayan range. And similar to Rickettsia, this genus Markansia, it also grows best in moist and shady places. And this particular plant called Markansia polymorpha, the variety has been named as Aquatica because it is found to be submerged in swamps. The gametophytic phase, the external morphology, let us see about the external morphology of the thallus or the plant body of Markansia. So this is a picture which is showing the external morphology of the plant. So you can see here clearly that the plant body, it is a prostrate, it is thalloid, it is dorsiventrally, it is flattened, and also it shows this dichotomous branching. And on the upper surface, that is on the dorsal surface of the thallus, a distinct midrib is present. And on the ventral surface, that is on the lower surface of the thallus, the scales and rhizoids are present. Now, there is another important characteristic feature or structure that is present on the dorsal surface of the plant body of Markansia. And that is the presence of these small cup-like elevated structures, which are known as gamma cups, which are not seen to be present in the genus Rickettsia. So these gamma cups, these are the means of asexual reproduction in case of Markansia. And within these gamma cups, some cup-shaped structures within this structure, some structures are present which are called gamete, and they are the method for asexual reproduction in Markansia. So this is a very peculiar and characteristic feature of the genus Markansia. Anatomically, the genus Markansia, this is a thallus, the TS of the thallus of Markansia, and you can distinctly see here two different regions. This upper colored region, this is known as the assimilatory region, upper assimilatory region, and this lower region, which is parenchymatous, and it is known as the storace region. Now you can see here, this assimilatory region, it is made up of these photosynthetic filaments. These are the photosynthetic filaments, which may be branched or they may be unbranched also. And they are responsible to carry on the process of photosynthesis within the plant body of Markansia, and that is why this region is known as assimilatory region. This is the upper epidermis, which is having this pore called air pore, and this upper epidermis, it forms some chamber-like structures enclosing these photosynthetic filaments, and these chambers are known as air chambers. So this is the upper assimilatory region in Markansia. Now, this lower storage region is made up of storage cells, which are parenchymatous, and they store or store the products of this photosynthetic region, that is stars, oil, and other substances. Now, on this lower epidermis of this lower storage region, the scales as well as the rhizoids are present. The rhizoids are again of two types, tuberculated, also known as the pegged rhizoids, because they run parallelly to the thallus, and smooth-walled rhizoids, and their function is same, that is they help in the process of anchorage of the thallus to the substratum. And the scales, their function is nutritive, and they function as conducting tissue to carry on water and other minerals to the plant body of Markensia. Reproduction. Markensia, it reproduces by this following three different methods: vegetative, asexual, and sexual. So let us see or discuss these three methods one by one. Vegetative mode of reproduction in case of Markensia takes place by these two different methods. Number one, by gradual death and decay of the older parts of the plant body. So this is a diagram. Here you can see how death and decay of the older part of the plant body following the fragmentation of the other parts can lead to the production of new plant body or new thallus in case of Markensia. And the second method is by adventitious branches that may either arise from the ventral surface of the thallus, or in Markensia, it may even rise from the disc of the archae goniophore, which is a female sex organ in Markensia. So after separation, these adventitious branches, they can also give rise to or produce new thallus in case of Markensia. So these are the two methods of vegetative reproduction in Markensia. Asexual method, it takes place by this gamete, by germination of these gamma cups or this gamete. So these gamma cups, as we have already discussed in our previous slides, that these are the means of asexual reproduction, because if we cut a section through this gamma cup, this is the gamma cup, these are the photosynthetic filaments, these are scales and rhizoids, and within this gamma cup you will see that these type of structures are present, known as gamete. Now this is an enlarged view of a gamete. So here you can see that it is composed of a stalk with which it is attached to this gamma cup. Then it encloses some oil cells, and these are the methods of asexual reproduction in case of Markensia. Sexual method. In case of Markensia, the sex organs are quite developed compared to the previous genus, that is Rickettsia. Now here you will see that the sex organs, they are special, they are born on special stalked receptacles, and these receptacles are known as the gametophores. Now these gametophores are again of two types. One is bearing the male sex organ called antridia, and the other is bearing the female sex organ called archegonia. And accordingly, they have been given these two different terms. One is called antridiophores and the other one is called archegoniophores. Now, unlike in case of Rickettsia, the thallus or plant body of Markensia, it is always heterothallic or dioecious. That means the single plant body, it produces both the male and female sex organs, that is the antridiophores and archegoniophores. So this male sex organ is called antridium, which is produced within antridiophores, and they ultimately produces the biflagellated antherozoids or sperms. And the female sex organ, it is called the archegonium, and it ultimately produces a single egg cell. And the most important point is what? That it also needs water to complete the process of fertilization after the maturity of these sex organs, antheridium and archegonium. So let us move on to the fertilization part, but before going to that, let us see the structure of this antheridiophore and archegoniophore. So this is the structure of antheridiophore in case of Merkensia, and this is the structure of archegoniophore. So if we cut a LS means the longitudinal section through this antheridiophore, then you will see a structure like this. Okay, so this is the stalk of the antheridiophore. Then these are the photosynthetic filaments, and these are the chambers within which the antheridia are produced, which are the male sex organs in case of Merkensia. And if we cut a LS again through this archegoniophore, then you will see a structure like this under the microscope. You can see clearly that this is the photosynthetic region. These are the female sex organs or the archegonium, which are enclosed within this perichaetium, and this is the stalk called archegoniophore. So this is the structure of the male and the female sex organs in case of Merkensia. Now let us see the structure of the antheridium or the male sex organ that is produced within this antheridiophore, and the archegonium or the female sex organ that is produced within this archegoniophore. So in case of the antheridium, you can see here it is enclosed within a chamber or a cavity, and this cavity is known as the antheridial cavity. So within this antheridial cavity, the androcyte mother cells are enclosed, which ultimately produces the sperms. And this is the ostiole or the opening through which after maturity, the spores may germinate or liberate. They will liberate so as to reach this female sex organ, that is archegonium. Now this archegonium, within at the center of it, it will produce a single large egg cell, which is well protected by different covering layers like this ventral canal cell, neck canal cell. Then this cover cell is also present on the top of this archegonium structure, and it is well protected within this ventral cavity, surrounded by this ventral wall. So these are the structures of the male and the female sex organs in case of Merkensia. Now when this male and female sex organs, they will mature, this male gamete, it will unite with the female gamete, and this process, we know, it is known as fertilization. The end product of the fertilization is the single cell zygote, or it is also called oospore, and water is always needed to carry on or to complete the process of fertilization in case of Merkensia also, like in the earlier genus, that is Rickettsia. So after the formation of this diploid zygote, which is also known as the oospore, which is a final product of fertilization, the sporophytic phase, it begins. And this diploid zygote or the oospore, it represents the first cell of the sporophytic generation. After that, this diploid zygote or this oospore, it will enlarge so as to completely fill the ventral cavity of the archegonium. It will also undergo repeated divisions so as to form several layered calyptra, which is enclosing the developing sporophyte, or also known as the sporogonium. And a matured sporophyte or sporogonium in case of Merkensia, it is differentiated into three distinct regions: foot, seta, and capsule. Unlike in case of Rickettsia, because in case of Rickettsia, we have already discussed that foot and seta, these are the sterile structures which are absent in the sporogonium or the sporophyte of Rickettsia, which is present in case of Merkensia. So that way, Merkensia, it is quite developed or advanced in structure compared to the sporophyte of Merkensia. This is a diagram which shows the structure of mature sporophyte or capsule of Merkinsia. So here you can clearly see what are the different parts which are present in the matured sporophyte or sporogonium. So this is the thallus or the plant body with which there is a massive foot, and the foot, the function of the foot is to attach this sporophyte or sporogonium to the plant body of Merkinsia. This portion is called the cytta, which is also a broad, very long, and then comes this calyptra, which is multiple layered in case of Merkinsia. This is the peridium. These are all the sterile tissues which are present in the sporophyte of Merkinsia. These are the, this is known as the, this portion is known as the capsule. And these elongated structures, these things, these are the elaters. And within these elaters, in between these elaters, the fertile tissue, that is the spores, are present. So spores are the only fertile tissue in the sporogonium or sporophyte of Merkinsia. And rest of all these tissues, like the second layer, the calyptra, elater, cytta, and foot, these are all the sterile tissues which are present in the sporophyte or sporogonium of Merkinsia. Then dehiscence of the sporogonium. How these spores will get liberated? So there is a dehiscence mechanism in case of Merkinsia sporophyte, and it takes place due to the elongation of this cytta. When the sporophyte will mature, it will be mature enough that the cytta will elongate rapidly, and it will push the capsule wall into the capsule in the air through these protective layers like calyptra, the peridium, and all. The ripe capsule wall then will burst, or it will dehiscence from apex to the middle to form or to by the producing 4 to 6 irregular valve which will liberate the spores that are enclosed within the capsule. So the annular thickenings in the cells of the capsule wall then causes these valves to roll back so as to expose the spores and elaters that is present within the capsule. The elaters are being hygroscopic in nature, and they will form a kind of jerking action. And due to this twisted and untwisted activity of these elaters, depending upon the presence or absence of water, the spore mass, it will loosen the spore mass, and the spores will be carried out by the air currents. So this is the dehiscence mechanism which is seen in case of Merkinsia sporophyte. Evolutionary significance. In our first class, we have already discussed, but still let us see how this Merkinsia sporophyte, it is present or it represents the evolutionary process of sporophyte development in bryophytes. So Merkinsia, it represents the fifth stage. If you can recall that there are 8 different stages, out of which Merkinsia, it represents the fifth stage according to the process or theory of progressive evolution of sporophytes. Now, in case of Merkinsia, we have already discussed in our previous slides that the sporophyte consists of a mushy foot, a long cytta is there, several other sterile tissues are also there, like the second layer of this capsule, this perigynium, calyptra, then in between elaters are also present, and among all the sterile tissues, a very small portion of fertile tissue, that is spores, are present. So that is why it represents the fifth stage in between Coccinea and Anthoceros. So evolutionary, from the viewpoint of evolution, the Merkinsia sporophyte is a very interesting and a very important genus in the process of evolution of sporophyte. This is the overall life cycle of Merkinsia. You can see here, this is the sporophytic generation and this is the gametophytic generation. Now, compared to the gametophytic generation, which is very prolonged, the sporophytic generation is very short. And The oospore or the diploid zygote, it represents the first cell in the process of life cycle, and the spores, as after the meiotic division, they represent the first cell in the process of gametophyte generation. So this way, the diploid zygote or oospore and the spores, they are producing or they are continuing the life cycle of Rickettsia in the form of gametophytic generation and sporophytic generation. So this is all about the overall life cycle of Merkensia. Thank you for watching. And if you think this is going to help you or it is helpful, this material, then please like and subscribe. Thank you for watching. Thank you once again.